What's up, YouTube? This your boy, JuKING the Boss, and microtransactions is the topic of the day. There are games that do microtransactions right. There are games that do them wrong. Now, this ain't going to be no top 10 list or nothing like that. We're going to go over general studies of microtransactions, the games and the way they do them, and the way we can avoid microtransactions in the future, because the way it looks, all companies are trying to go along the route of making microtransactions a big part of the game. And the problem with that is that implemented improperly means the downfall of a beloved game, a beloved title, beloved series, and then implemented properly in the right games means that those are the ones we're going to see more of. So let's talk about a few games that I've played and how they implemented them and where did I feel they went wrong with. So first we're going to look at NBA 2K18. Now, NBA 2K18 VC implementations was kind of poorly done. It's not because it's like to say, oh man, they introduced VC out of nowhere. Nah, they just increased the prices of everything affordable with VC, and at the same time decreased the amount of VC you can earn, especially starting out. Now, I showed you ways that you can earn better VC as you go, as you progress through the first season of your career, unlocking sponsorships and things like that. I'll leave some cards up of those. But when it comes down to it, earning VC became more of a chore than it became a fun factor in the game. You know, you can play so many different modes, and I like the fact that they eliminated the road to 99 from being something that you have to play, My Career, Park, and Pro-Am just to get there. You can play either one of them, you can play all of them, but you don't have to focus on playing one of them if you don't want to. So you don't have to be one who has to play My Career and play Park in order to get to 99. If you want to play nothing but My Career, you can do that. If you want to play nothing but Park, you can do that. And the same thing goes with Pro-Am. So when I look at that and I said, okay, that's a great addition to the game. But when you look at the VC and the way it's like, when you first buy the game, you're literally given almost no choice to buy VC based on the way that everything is presented to you. You know, you playing your first game and you see, oh, you're only gonna get 750 VC until you start getting some actual minutes. And then you get to the point where it's like, you're not gonna, when you go play at the park, you see cats who are 85 and everything. Now, when it comes down to the YouTubers who buy the VC so that way they can show the upgrade capabilities of a character and what he can do at a certain level, this, that, and the other. You know, that's one thing. You know, that it's always cool to attract the sharks, but it's another thing when it's like, we don't just want a few of y'all to purchase VC. We want all of y'all to purchase VC. When you look at the smaller options, like the smaller options are a joke. The 5,000 VC and the 35,000 VC, those are a joke of an options, because you literally can't really get anywhere with those two options that warrant the price that you put into them. So essentially you pay $150 or $160 in total from the money that you spend on the game and the money that you have to spend on VC in order to get your man to competitive level to play in all of the game modes. You know, now me wasn't going to buy VC, not planning on buying VC, because I know there's so many ways I can earn VC, and I've gotten my man to 90. It's a proud achievement for me in the game, and I keep trying to find ways for others to grow their man and grow their characters without having to sit up here and shell more money out of pocket. So it was a poor way to introduce VC, and I think that it's a statement that moving forward, you got to look at it and say, this is a game that has a year-long life cycle. That's it. It doesn't have a 2-3-year-long life cycle. It has a year-long life cycle. They give the game an additional year of online services and things like that, but after that they cut the services off. So why would I spend $60 plus an extra $200 for two characters that after a couple years will be no good to me? Now, a lot of people will say that a lot of games that got microtransactions don't last forever. You're right, but they're also not built to just last a year. Like, 2K knows is a game that's built to last just a year. The second that the game is done and getting ready to ship, they're already working on the next year's installment. So when you know you got a game that's not built to last but a year, then the way you implement your VC, your cash grab, if you will, should be better suited, so that way those who don't want to invest in the virtual currency in a game, the microtransactions in a game, they don't have to, and it doesn't feel like they have to struggle as hard. Now, like I said, I didn't have to struggle for real, because I found all the different ways that I can earn my VC at a better rate. But not that information wasn't readily available to everybody, and you know, I shared what I could, what I came across as I did it. But when at the beginning of a game, when that, none of that information is out there, you know, people are just sitting there looking like, oh nah, I can't play this because this is just too much. They want me to pay an extra $50, an extra $100 to increase VC. Now, don't get me wrong, if they do it like last year where they had it so you got the additional sales, like they do discounts on clothing and things like that, okay, bet. But because you're not doing those things now, it hurts your community right away. It hurts your community right out the gate. You know, when you wait till cats get to 99 and there's nothing left for their character to spend their VC on, you know, of course they're gonna sit up here and buy clothes. But by that time, they would have already bought all the clothes that they wanted. And they're gonna just be building that VC up to build on, to put toward another character. So when you really break it down, it's more along lines of like the amount that you pay to play or pay to win should not be so high when the game literally has a year long life cycle. All right, so another staple of the Take-Two family created by Rockstar Games is Grand Theft Auto 5. Now, Grand Theft Auto 5 to me is one of the best uses of microtransactions in a game that you pay a premium price for at already. And the reason why I say that is because the shark cards are available to everybody, but you don't have to get them at all, and the grind doesn't feel too unnecessary. Like if you're playing different missions and you're doing different missions and different ways to play the game and so many different additional things, you can earn this. You can earn by, you know what I'm saying, stealing cars and selling them. You can earn by, you know, doing the bank heist in the game and things like that. You can earn Bitcoin, and as you level up, you can earn even more and more coin because you got bigger tiered operations that are put in front of you and things like that. You can, and then when it comes down to it, so you attract, they attract the bigger fish, the sharks with the shark cards. You know, hey look, give them $100, we'll give you 10 million in virtual currency, and that virtual currency they'll use to start a motorcycle club or organization, and they'll have their subscribers a part of that organization, and they'll run with some of their subscribers. Like it's a way to benefit for both sides of the spectrum, where it increases the longevity. And the thing about it is that the reason why I say it's one of the best ways that they implemented shark cards is because you can literally tell that the money that people are still spending on the game, they're saying, okay, this game still has viability, it still has life, so we can continue to invest in this game and things like that. So you get more DLC to come out, more free content that comes with it. And you don't see that with a lot of games. You got DLC and then you got microtransactions. Two different things. DLC is supposed to add additional content to the game, whereas microtransactions are smaller prices to increase your ability to progress or fast stream your progression. So when it comes down to it, GTA is a paid game that I really felt implemented microtransactions the best way possible. And these are from the games that I've played. There are other games that I've played that have microtransactions, but I didn't stick around with them long enough because of the microtransactions, but because of the way the game played out to me. It wasn't one of those things where I felt like I was earning big, or I looked at it and said, I'm earning way too much too soon. At one point, it's going to stale out. And so let me just get out now, because then I become one of them cats who are complaining about the fact that, oh, it's fizzing out on me. And now it's like, oh, if I want to get to this next tier, I'm going to have to throw some money up. So, you know, there are a couple of games that do microtransactions well. GTA is one of those paid games that do it well, that I don't have really too many complaints about. There are a couple of issues that I'm always going to have about microtransactions in the game, but if you are asking somebody to invest additional money in virtual currency, but at the same time you're creating additional content for that game that increases the game's longevity, that extends the game's life cycle, then people are going to invest in that. This is why you don't get too many complaints about a game that increases the longevity. And I've done videos on games that talked about how this game was going to last this long, and I looked at it and I said, no, it ain't. And this was one of those games where it was like, I looked at it and said, well, I say the microtransactions, I said, as long as they keep adding to this online world, they're going to have some fun with it and people are going to invest in it. But we're going to go over another game, a free-to-play game that I felt really does microtransactions better than almost any other game. And I would love to know if there's another game that you know that does it better than this game, Warframe. Now, Without a shadow of a doubt, Warframe was a game that I got into, and I really, me and my boys, we played the mess out of that free-to-play game. And when I looked at the microtransactions at the very beginning, I was like, man, they really want you to put some money up, don't they? They really want. But once you really start to understand the game and how to play the game and how to do the missions and how to advance in the game, and then you really see all the different things that you can earn in the game just by playing the game, it's all there for you to earn. I'm saying, oh, wow, they taking a real big chance with this one. This is a really big chance, because you don't have to get any of that in-game currency. But when you purchase, some of that in-game currency to kind of shortcut you earning a Warframe or shortcut you getting a specific weapon, that's not one of those things where it's like, oh, that was a cash grab. No, because they'll do an event for 30 days, and that event might get you a prime Warframe, like a prime Rhino Warframe. And so you got 30 days to complete this event, where you got to go to these different levels, go to these different missions and do these missions and do these particular things. And each one of them, you'll be granted a piece, a helmet, one of the parts of the blueprint, and then you got to build the Warframe. And so when it comes down to it, you can buy that virtual currency, and you probably don't use it to shortcut buying the Warframe. You probably use it to shortcut building the Warframe, because as soon as you got all the pieces, it's going to take 24 hours or 48 hours to completely build each of these pieces. No, it's going to take 24 hours or 12 hours to build each of these pieces. And then once that's done, you got to find the blueprint, or you already have the blueprint, and then you gotta put it all together. So after you've built each piece, now you gotta put it all together. So now you've built all these pieces, now you just gotta combine them all, and it's like, all right, this is gonna take 24 hours. You're like, oh nah, forget all that. Let me get $5 worth of this virtual currency real quick and fast track that. I'm trying to put this bad boy on now, and I got some missions I wanna run through with this joint now. But at the same time, you can say, you know what, I'm gonna wait for that 24 hours. I'm patient. I'm good with it. And when it comes down to it, for a free-to-play game to have a space where you don't need to buy any of the virtual currency to succeed, but you can. Now, when the game first came out, you was able to earn, like, you was able to get the prime Excalibur Warframe, and then there was a point in time where you wasn't able to get that prime Excalibur Warframe no more. Then there was a time where you was able to buy it, you know, and that prime Excalibur Warframe was because it was for the people who kind of like got in on the ground floor, got in when the game first came out, and so they gave them that opportunity a short time after to earn it. And you know, if you missed that opportunity, then you can purchase it, and I think that's gone altogether. But when it boils down to it, you can play this game, have fun playing this game, doing all these different missions, play missions with up to three of your friends, because you can do four player missions and things like that. And each person succeeds together, we grow together. And then there were little things where it was more online. Like, don't get me wrong, they implemented certain little things that you usually see in a mobile game, where it was like you'd have to wait a few hours before you can do this again. And I think that was only with the training, if I'm correct. It's been a while since I played it, but I remember when you get to your next level and you had to do your training, you had to complete your 10-0 training to get your next rank. If you failed it, you had to wait to do it again. And I didn't mind that, because the simple fact is that, like I said, we talking about a game that they keep adding content to, they keep adding more missions to, they keep adding more worlds to, and they say, look, you gotta hold out, you know what I'm saying, on this, or you can buy this little virtual currency right here, and you'll be able to try it again, and things like that. And people will say, that's a cash grab. It's not. It's a way to combat, you know what I'm saying, the longevity of the game. By extending the longevity of the game, people investing in it. I think I spent about $80 on virtual currency in that game and everything. And to me, that game's worth more than that. You know, there are people who probably spent $300, $400 in virtual currency for that game. And people look at that and say, man, them people lost their mind. Them people are stupid. Nah, they're not, because they're playing a game that was created in 2013 and it's still valid to this day. And they're still adding content to it to this day. And so when it comes down to it, I look at some of these games and I say, some of these games are toeing the line, and some of these games are jumping over the line when it comes down to microtransactions. This is a game that showed how to implement microtransactions over the life cycle of the game and increase the longevity of the game. So, you know, now we're going to go over a few, the few of the different companies that do microtransactions and the future of what we can expect from how they're doing it if we don't kind of step in and just do something about it on our side of it as the consumer. All right, finally, I'm going to go over Red Dead Redemption 2. Red Dead Redemption 2 set to release in the spring of 2018, and that's a game I'm looking forward to, and I'm hoping it follows a similar path of GTA Online's microtransactions, because GTA Online is a fun game to play online, like even to this very day. They added so much to the game, and that's all coming from the fact that they have microtransactions in the game. It allows them to reinvest in the game, increase the longevity of the game, and that is why I call it one of the perfect examples. That and Warframe are two perfect examples of increasing longevity by using microtransactions and adding to the layers of the game. You got a base layer, and then you add another layer, and then you add another layer, and when we think you can't add another layer, you throw another layer up there. And so I want to see Red Dead Redemption 2 take that same path, and because can't nobody say they don't want to play in the Wild West as a gunslinger with running with your mob that you usually run in all these other games with. That's going to be fun. I'm going to enjoy that. I'm going to enjoy seeing the content that people create from that, you know. So when it comes down to it, the last thing I just got to say is that I'm hoping that the publishers of game companies see the video and don't look at it and say that I'm just chastising you or throwing you under the bus or putting you down or saying that everything you do is wrong. No, your developers create great products, and then sometimes there are certain parts of it that's executed. There are a lot of games that go on this list, but I kind of wanted to go over some of the ones that are out and coming out that to me affected me now and could affect us in the future. So, you know, this like I said, I'm just hoping that when you see the video, you know, you just kind of give it a good little listen and understand that this isn't a way of saying that every developer or every publisher is wrong. I know I complained. I know to me it sounded like I was complaining about the 2K, and I probably was. But I wasn't complaining because it's like, oh, I'm at a point where I can't do nothing. I can't earn nothing. No. You know, I'm at a point where I'm still grinding to get there, and I'm earning VC along the way. I'm actually spending VC to buy skill boosts as I do it because I can't really level up just yet. So, you know, I just want the publishers to know that as a community, I don't want to see the community diminish as we get older and the younger generation comes in, because the simple fact is that the game is already unaffordable out the gate. So, you know, I understand that additional content is introduced in games now to expand the cost of the game without actually expanding the cost of the game. You buy a $60 game now, you look at the way game prices went up, you buy a $60 game now and then it's got like $40 in DLC. That's because for real the price of a game is really like $100, like $99.99. If that was the base price of a game, I look at it and say, oh, say they finally figured it out. But when it comes down to it, by making the game $60, you make it accessible to more. You make it accessible to all, as opposed to saying that game's $100. Oh, I can't do that. You know, it's not accessible to anybody anymore. So, you know, I enjoy the way games are going in the creativity department, but I would like to see them reevaluate the additional microtransactions to make the game better. You know, this your boy JuKING the Boss. I hope you stayed through the whole video. Sorry that it was so long, but I just had to get that all off my chest, man. I'm hoping that we get something from it. I'm hoping that we move forward as a community of gamers in the best light possible, man. And until next time, I'll catch you guys later. I'm out.